Okay, so you read about the digestive system, and we're going to go over some really important points that you're going to want to be able to keep track of for moving forward here and some of the activities we're going to do. So, as you read about, obviously the digestive system are the organs that break down food so that your body can use it, right? Earlier this year, we talked about cellular respiration, and today we'll see a little video that talks a little bit about how those particles get broken down and built back up so that they can travel in your blood and be taken where your body can use them for energy. So there's two types of digestion, which your book mentioned. One is mechanical. Think about the word mechanics. So it's the crushing and mashing of food, and typically that happens in your mouth by your teeth. Then we have chemical digestion, which also can happen in your mouth when saliva, which has enzymes that break down your food, starts to be released in your mouth. Even when you think about being hungry, your body releases saliva. You start to, what we say, salivate, right? So that's important, but also, excuse me, also in your stomach, there are acids that help break down food. So a chemical actually happens in your mouth and in your stomach. So that's important to note as well. If we didn't have these types of digestion, chemical and mechanical, digestion would take even longer than it already does take. So that's important. So this kind of will be discussed a little bit more in a video that we're going to watch in a little bit. But what happens is these enzymes are like what we say chemical scissors, right? They cut along these chains of amino acids and they put them into smaller groups. You can see here in the second part, and even smaller, right? That they can follow into your bloodstream and go and give energy to your cells and make new proteins. And they have a really important job. So a lot is happening when you digest food. So this is just a basic picture, and we're going to work with this a little bit more when we do some activities here, but you could follow food from your mouth all the way through to where it's digested, and eventually the parts that you can't digest obviously get taken out in your feces, in your poop eventually. So you could follow this, right? And we'll kind of do that a little bit today. So, organs of a digestion. First, we have the mouth, right? That's where it all starts. Your teeth crush the food. We talked about mechanical. And then saliva chemically starts to break down the food. It's released those enzymes in your mouth. Then you have the esophagus, right? That connects to the pharynx, to the stomach. And peristalsis, which is this really cool process where there are these muscular contractions that push food down into your stomach, starts to happen. Peristalsis, don't do this at home, but if you were upside down trying to swallow food, peristalsis would push the food into your, down into your stomach eventually, even though you're upside down, if that makes sense to you. So it's a pretty strong muscular contraction that happens. And then the stomach, of course, is a sac-like organ. It's the lower end of your esophagus. And again, you have mechanical and chemical digestion here. The food is churned, the acids in your stomach break it down. And some people would say, well, how can our stomach be so acidic and not, burn through the lining of our stomach? Well, there's a lining in your stomach that actually is protective. So most people are fine. Sometimes you can get what's called an ulcer that can be caused by bacteria that kind of break away at that lining and you get kind of, some burning and stuff like that. So usually it's fine, but you can kind of see in that picture here, the stomach is kind of in above the intestines and next to the liver, and the esophagus meets the stomach there. Then we have chyme. Some people want to say chyme. Chyme is where the soupy mixture ends up happening. That's what it is. It reminds me a little bit of like oatmeal or like, kind of a soupy mixture that you would eventually break all that food down into, and then the stomach releases it into the small intestine. Now, interestingly enough, most digestion takes place in the small intestine. Even though it has what we say a small width or diameter, it's actually really long. It's 6 meters long. And there's this area, I call them like little rooms, right? Where they're called villi, and they actually, allow there to be a lot of room for that food. And if you flattened them out, they would be larger than a tennis court. That's pretty crazy to think about. That is all in your stomach. So the small intestine is actually longer than the large intestine. It's just more narrow. So you can see the small intestine kind of circled here. And there are these little rooms or villi. Then we have the pancreas. Food does not go through the pancreas. That's an important thing to remember, but it does make enzymes and hormones that help us regulate our blood sugar. So if you know someone who might be diabetic, their pancreas might not work correctly, and they have to take medicine or do various things to help them be able to regulate their blood sugar. Now we have the liver. Food also does not pass through the liver. The liver is right up here, this organ right here. It's a very large organ. It's reddish brown. It stores bile that actually breaks up fat. So it releases bile and helps digest your food. However, food doesn't pass through it. It also stores and filters blood, sugars, glycogen. It stores them and nutrients. So you need to be careful of your liver, what you're putting through your liver, because drugs build up there. So we have to be careful that we're not taking things we shouldn't be, and that we're, making sure that we have nutrition included in that so that our liver can function. And it also breaks down toxins. So toxins kind of build up in it. So you got to be careful that you're taking good care of your liver. Your gallbladder, which also does not have food pass through it, and you can live without it. It does have a job though. So it's not a vestigial structure. It's a sac-shaped organ, which also stores bile. Now, sometimes people get what are called gallstones, and their gallbladder kind of acts up. You can have it taken out. But your body does use it. And so there's your third organ, along with your liver and your pancreas, that food doesn't pass through, but is very, very important to digestion. Then we have the large intestine. It's called the large intestine because it's very wide. It's actually shorter, though, and it's kind of around your small intestine. This is where things kind of get broken down that can be and taken where they need to go. But certain things that we can't digest, like fiber, stuff sticks to it, which is why we want fiber in our diet. That actually ends up going out into our feces, out our rectum, and the opening is called the anus. So basically, it's kind of the last call for if things should go where it needs to go, like water and stuff like that, or if it can't be digested, it hops out of your body. So you can see the large intestine is wide, it's kind of around the outside here. And then the small intestine is inside. Okay, so we already answered this question, but this is one I want you to be thinking about and remembering, those three organs that food doesn't pass through. Also, just to mention the large intestine, your colon, which is part of, you have an ascending and a descending colon, that is part of your large intestine, if you've ever heard anyone talk about that. And we'll also be talking about some disorders in the next few days related to the digestive system. We will come back together now.